Buenos días, ¿cómo están? Tenemos un invitado muy especial, invitado por el programa de diseño industrial. Es el profesor Sai Lulio. El profesor Sai Lulio es el director del Departamento de Diseño Gráfico e Industrial de la Escuela de Diseño de North Carolina State University. Para darles un poquito de información sobre el profesor Liu, él es diseñador industrial. Él ha tenido amplia experiencia profesional desde 1995, trabajando con compañías muy importantes en Taiwán y Estados Unidos. Y desde el 2004 se ha dedicado a la docencia del diseño industrial. A partir del 2012, él se convirtió en el director del departamento de la Escuela de Diseño Gráfico e Industrial. Y lo hemos invitado porque queremos recibir un poquito de información sobre cómo son los procesos y cómo es la visión y la perspectiva del diseño industrial en North Carolina State University. Entonces, profesor, bienvenido.
Yeah. Welcome. Yeah, thank you. Great to be here.
Okay. So first, our first question is regarding your college.
Okay. Yeah?
So I'm gonna ask it in Spanish. Nuestra primera pregunta es sobre la manera en que está organizada la escuela de diseño. ¿Cómo se inscribe dentro de la universidad y cómo interactúa con otras escuelas y a nivel interdisciplinar?
Okay. North Carolina is the number 9 state in terms of population in the United States, and there are about 10 million people in North Carolina. And NC State University is the biggest university in the entire North Carolina. And the College of Design is a small college in a big, big university, but is well established, well respected. In the College of Design, we have 4 departments: architecture, landscape architecture, art and design. That's one department. They focus on fashion design and animation and new media. And my department has graphic design and industrial design. So graphic design has master degree and also undergrad degree. Industrial design also have master degree and undergrad degree. In the college, in addition to these 4 departments, we also have a PhD program in design. So that's PhD in design. So basically 4 academic units, and I'm the head of graphic design and industrial design.
¿Cuántos estudiantes tiene el colegio, la escuela? How many students does the school have?
Okay, my department has about 250 students, both undergrad and graduate students. And I have 15 faculty members.
15?
15, yeah, 15, yeah.
This number of students, how are they divided between graphic and industrial?
Okay.
¿Cómo están divididos los estudiantes entre gráfico e industrial?
Yeah. We have a little bit more graphic design students. For undergrad students, undergrad programs, industrial design, we have 18 in a year. Mm-hmm. Graphic design, we have 28 a year. That's undergrad. In our graduate program, we have about 30 master of industrial design students. We have about 25 graphic design master students.
Okay. Now that we're talking about, ahora que estamos hablando un poco de las particularidades de la escuela, nos gustaría saber un poquito de información sobre el currículo. ¿Cómo está organizado? ¿Qué particularidades tiene? We would like to know a little bit of the curriculum.
Okay.
What do you think make the school like stand out from?
Okay. Yeah. I'm very fortunate to lead this program. The department has very good reputation in the United States. And I think this is with the Faculty of Product Design. I'm going to talk a little bit more on the industrial design curriculum. So our undergrad program is a 4 years program. 4 years industrial design program. The students receive a Bachelor of Industrial Design degree when they graduate. And it's very competitive to get in. Every year we receive about 100 applications from high school students. We take only 18, and the students have to submit their portfolio when they apply for applying to our program. The faculty review the portfolio. So the students come in already knowing how to draw. So it's a 4 years program. The most important, we call it sequence, with a series of courses. The most important sequence is a studio sequence. The studio is a term that used very commonly in the United States. That's a class that students practice design. It's similar to a design office. So the students come in, they spend most of the time in their studio. And we have the first year, second year, third year, and the fourth year, and the capstone studios. That's the most important sequence. So that is, the student have to take one studio every semester. They spend about 10 hours in the studio, and also during the studio hour, but they spend a lot of time outside the studio hour, in the studio working on their projects. And also we have other sequence to support the studio sequence, for example, the drawings, ideation, sketching, in teaching students the styling and illustration. And also we have another sequence is computer sequence, for example, SolidWorks, Rhinos, Adobe Suite. So that's a computer sequence. But we also have another sequence, internal knowledge. We have the design thinking, design methods, material and process. That's the main sequence and supporting the studio. And in the studio, every semester at the end of studio class, the students need to produce some portfolio pages. So when the end of semester, they have some portfolio pages, and so they can go out when they're looking for internship or looking for full-time job, their portfolios are almost ready. So that's a part of the outcome of the studio sequence. In terms of our graduate programs, we have two tracks of master program. We have one we call the track two for the students already have an industrial design or product design undergrad degree. They come in and do 2 years. They spend half the time in design research, half the time doing designs. So at the end of their study, they have both a research portfolio and the design portfolio. We also have another track, the 3 years master program, we call the track three. For those students without any design degree, without industrial design degree, some students may come in with a fine art degree or English or philosophy or mechanical engineering degree. They come in and spend 3 years. They receive a master of industrial design degree. And they spend pretty much the first year laying the foundations, but the next 2 years working on more advanced design. So that's pretty much the overall picture of our curriculum.
El profesor Liu mencionó anteriormente la población de profesores de tiempo completo. Es una gran población teniendo en cuenta el número reducido de la población de estudiantes. ¿Qué características tiene esta población de profesores de tiempo completo? ¿De qué profesiones vienen? ¿Son multidisciplinares o en su mayoría diseñadores industriales? So the question is, you mentioned earlier that you had a high population of full-time staff teachers compared to the population of students. What are the backgrounds of these professors? Are they all industrial design, or is the approach of the faculty more multidisciplinary?
Okay, that's a very good question. And that's something we are still trying to figure out the best portfolio of our faculty. But right now I'm very proud of my faculty. If we talk about industrial design, I have 8 full-time industrial design faculty members, 8 professors. And so usually many industrial design programs, they use industrial designers to teach multiple courses. So for example, the teacher teaching human factors, they are, most of the time they are industrial designers, but they might have some interest or expertise in human factors, in ergonomics. It works well, but sometimes, sometimes students, especially graduate students, would like to see more in-depth understanding or knowledge of the faculty. So it's interesting that in my faculty, which I'm very proud of, we had some 3 or 4 faculty members, they were very experienced industrial designers, so they were practicing designers. But on the faculty also, we have some faculty members, they specialize certain area. For example, the faculty member, the professor teaching human factors, she received her PhD in human factors, in ergonomics. Mm-hmm. And the faculty member, the professor teaching styling, teaching sketches, he used to be a car designer. So it's just perfect for him to teach styling. We have a faculty member teaching design history. He is a historian. So you can see that we, and also we have a faculty member teaching entrepreneurship. He started many different companies. So you can see that we have very specialized faculty members, having very good and very in-depth understanding in their areas. But in the meantime, we have some faculty members, they were in the practicing areas. I feel like we have very good combination of the faculty.
Una combinación muy interesante de conocimiento práctico con conocimiento académico. Mm-hmm. A very interesting combination of practical knowledge with academic knowledge. Speaking of that subject, hablando de ese tema, nosotros en nuestra conversación que tuvimos el día de ayer, se mencionó un poco la colaboración que tiene NC State y la Escuela de Diseño con la empresa privada. Nos gustaría saber un poco cómo es la investigación, por un lado, en la escuela, y por otro, esa interacción con la empresa privada. So the question is, on our conversation yesterday, you mentioned about the interaction that exists between the college and the private sector. So we would like to know a little bit about the role that both research plays in the college and that collaboration with the private sector.
Okay. That is something that I started establishing when we already have a good foundation, but I really enforce and enhance the collaboration with the industry. So in my department, we have 2 kinds of collaborations. One is research focus. So this might be done by graduate students, including PhD students. They might take on some projects focusing on research, working with the companies. So the task could be as simple as how to enhance the ergonomics of a device. So we might spend lots of efforts into the details, supported by lots of knowledge in ergonomics. But this, we could generate a lot of very valuable knowledge for the companies. So that's something we do, the research focus, the study. But for our undergrad students, we are doing a lot of collaboration with the industry. We've been working with companies like Coca-Cola, like Bosch, Siemens, home appliance. The projects, the companies come to the studio, the class, and the company provide a project. For example, how to make the dishwasher easy to use. So the students have to do user research, have to study how people use the dishwashers, then come up with a new design of the dishwashers. A good design these days have to be a result of good research. So our students are very used to have a good understanding of the interaction between the user and the, and the products, and then we discover insights, possibilities or problems, and then come up with solutions. And this sponsor project is really helpful to our students. One thing is, a lot of times these companies come in, they do a project, and first of all, they are very, most of the time they are very pleased with the result of the project, and many of the projects actually are on the way to the marketplace. The companies are manufacturing, producing the products based on the student's design. And a lot of times the companies identify good students in a class and offer them internship opportunities in the summer. And then some students do really well in the internship, and then some students get a full-time position as soon as they graduate. So that's a very good path. And the students will have opportunity to work on the real world projects, working with the professionals. They come in once a week, or once to every 2 weeks to interact with the students, to coach, to mentor the students in the project. So the students, not only they learn design from the professors, but also they have some professional advice. So they will be more prepared professionally. So that's something we are working on, and I think it has been very successful.
En el tiempo que llevamos interactuando con el profesor, hemos visto muchas similitudes entre el programa de diseño industrial y y la escuela de diseño gráfico e industrial de North Carolina State University. Más o menos, pues, ¿cómo ve el profesor Liu la colaboración entre nuestras instituciones? So the question is, in the time that we have interacted, we've seen a lot of similarities between our institutions. How do you see our collaboration? How do you see what possible outcomes do you see of it?
Okay, good. I'm really excited by the friendship between Tadio and NC State University. We have two visiting scholars from your university come to visit us, spend a lot of time with us. And also I'm really glad to have the opportunity to come to visit and have a first-hand understanding of your program, your faculty and the students. And I really glad to see this friendship and partnership continues. So there are many venues we can be working on. For example, we have very good graduate programs, and your best students could consider coming to study and get a master's degree or even PhD degrees in my college. And also in your summer vacation or winter vacation, your students might consider coming over. We might have some courses or workshop offered to your students, and so they can come over and work with our faculty and students and maybe the professionals in our area. So the students have opportunity to learn and to experience how design students and designers work in the United States. So that's very good opportunity as well. And if there are some appropriate courses that my faculty could contribute, I think we can invite them, encourage them to come over and be a part of your international programs. So I'm sure there are many other ways we can collaborate, but I really feel like we have a very good foundation for collaboration, and I think we can continue and elevate the partnership.
Professor Liu, thank you very much, and hope you enjoy your rest of time in Colombia.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
Thanks.
Pues nada, vamos a hacer, como diría Santiago, le vamos a hacer honra a la puntualidad de muchos de ustedes. Santiago está en una reunión en este momento, entonces se excusa por no poder hacer la introducción del profesor Sailu. Queremos darles la bienvenida, inicialmente las gracias por supuesto, porque veo muchos profesores de cátedra y pues es un gusto tenerlos aquí en un momento pues donde evidentemente todavía no hemos iniciado clases, pero creo que vale la pena. Nada, hoy nos acompaña el profesor Sailu. Él es el director del Departamento de Diseño Industrial y Diseño Gráfico de la Universidad de NC State, Norte de Carolina. Y bueno, por algunas actividades académicas que hemos venido desarrollando con la Universidad de NC State, tuvimos en algún momento el gusto del profesor Camilo Angulo. Se me fue Camilo. ¡Ay, Camilo! El profesor Camilo Angulo y yo tuvimos el gusto de estar cada uno un periodo académico en NC State, y esto nos permitió en ese momento también como abrir otros nexos y otras posibilidades de trabajos académicos, tanto para profesores como para estudiantes, y justamente esas posibilidades son las que estamos intentando compartir con el profesor Sailú hoy aquí. Pero además de eso, desde luego, nos interesa que compartamos mucho de la experiencia que el profesor Sailú tiene en el área del diseño, no solamente como académico, como representante pues de la Universidad de NC State, sino también en el ejercicio mismo de la profesión. Parte de eso creo que es lo que él nos va a compartir hoy. Yo no lo voy a presentar porque nos está solicitando que le demos el tiempo suficiente para que él también se pueda presentar. Entonces, pues gracias and welcome, Professor Lu, and it's for you the
okay. Yeah, thank you. I got my microphone. Yeah.
Andrés puede hacer traducción si ustedes necesitan hacer preguntas o algo por el estilo.
Okay, it's great to be here. Sorry I don't speak Spanish, so I know only English and Chinese, and I think I probably you prefer me to use English. I'm going to speak slower. This presentation is, you, if I speak very fast, will be about an hour long. I will speak very slowly, so it might take 3 hours. Just kidding. Okay. Yeah. The one thing about being a designer and a design educator, I tend to be playful, because you know the word playful, just, you know, kind of like jolly. Because I think playful students are more creative than the students coming in with a long face. So that's so anyway. So it's my privilege to be here, and this is my first. I've been to Central America, but I travel to many different countries throughout my professional career. But this is surprisingly my first South America visit. And so far, I've been enjoying every minute of it. So yes, it's good to be here. Okay, I am going to speak a little bit about my perspective of the future of design practice and design education. Certainly, they are very connected. And, again, it's my perspective. People have very different views, and I'm open to discussion. Okay, but you might, because people have different views. People have different views, and this is my perspective after 12 years experience in industry and 11 years of teaching. Okay, and the future I'm referring to is not about 20 years later. Not 30 years later, the future, I mean the immediate future. Something's happening right now, and something I think is going to happen in the next 5 to 10 years. Okay, and so, about myself, okay, I'm a professor of industrial design, and I am the head of graphic design and industrial design. There used to be two departments, and two departments merged a few years ago, and I was hired to be the head of the joint department. And in the United States, they have different, their interest in terms. It's a head, not a tail. Okay, it's a head. So because many programs, they have chairs or directors, and the head is more permanent. So, you know, my previous school, the head was the head for 25 years. So that's I'm more permanent. It's a more permanent position. Welcome. Okay, and I started there in 2012, and this is NC State. First of all, North Carolina is the internal population is the number 9 state in the United States. We have about 10 million people. I know Bogota has probably 10 million people around Bogota, but the entire state has about 10 million people. It's number 9 in the United States. It's still growing very fast. in probably 15 years, going to be number 7 internal population of North Carolina. And NC State University is the biggest university in the entire North Carolina with about 35,000 students. It's a very research oriented school. The international ranking, the ranking of university is the top 100 universities in the United States. That's NC State. We have a very big engineering school and a big science school. And the college of design I'm working for is probably the smallest college in the campus, in the university. So I'm very jealous of the status of the design program in Tavio, because you are a very big college and we are a tiny college in a huge university. So sometimes engineering, our engineering college has 8,000 students. In the College of Design, it had only 800 students. So it's like big brother and small brother. So again, we are making an impact on campus. Okay, and so this is we have a very big campus. It's huge. I don't even know how big the campus is. Just huge. A lot of land, and this is just one corner of the university. We have a tower, because the university was established in 1850s. So at that period of time, not many people had to watch. So they had a lot of universities had their tower, but actually this is to memorize in memory of the many students attending World War II. So that's a tower, it's a new tower. Okay, and that's a university chancellor's building, and the College of Design is just over there. Okay, and this is the new library of NC State, a very expensive one, very modern, and we don't have lots of books. All the books are in the shelves and retrieved by robots. And so most space in the library are used for discussions and teamwork. And so there's a very good space, and there's a new concept of university library. People go there not to read books, they go there to work together. So a lot of small rooms for students to interact. That's probably gonna be the future of library, has been featured in many magazines. So that's NC State, and this is, we have three buildings. College of Design has three buildings, and this is one of the buildings, and this is in the spring, very beautiful, got lots of flowers, and old buildings. So you can see that because we have a lot of lands, so all our buildings are one or two floors, and here you have a lot of high rises. You know, today I went up and down many stairs, right? I could get my exercise. But there we don't have many stairs we had to do. Okay, and NC State is in Raleigh, North Carolina, and Raleigh is considered, been voted many times as one of the best city in the United States to work and live, and also got voted as the one of the city of the future. Okay, so it's kind of the applicable since we are talking about the future of design. Okay, and there are about 66 industrial design programs in the United States. There are quite a few. Basically, every state has at least one industrial design program, and the state of North Carolina has two. Okay, and out of these 66 programs, there's a ranking agency. Some people agree, some people are very suspicious about how they come out with the ranking, but at least that's the ranking, that the only ranking of these 66 programs. And this is this year's ranking. So you can see that internal undergrad program, we are number 9. And if you ask me if I am very happy with number 9, I'm not. I think we should be much higher, but that's out there. But in terms of number 9, in terms of 66 program, we are doing fine. We are very well respected. And our graduate program, the Master of Industrial Design program, is number 4. All these 66 programs, most of them have graduate programs. So we are number 4. We are highly regarded. So some of your students, if you are considering pursuing a master degree in the United States, that could be something I consider. And certainly I know you. And by the way, I really appreciate for those coming over, because I know this is your vacation, right? This is your holiday. You don't need to be here. But you decided to come, so that make me even more appreciative. For those people don't have to come, but willing to come, interested in coming, I think you are interested in learning and exchanging. I think that's great. I'm really grateful for your presence here. Okay, and so the beautiful friendship between Tadio and NC State College of Design, College of Design staff from the Camilla. One day he just came to my office, say hi. We had a very good conversation. So he decided that he come over to a visiting as a visiting scholar, and he spent some very good time in North Carolina, and also we started the collaboration, and after Camilo, Miss Deanna is there, right? So she spent 6 months there, and we had a great time. She came to my class 2 times a week, and she is on time most of the time. Yeah, so sometimes she's late, but she's working very hard. And this is another student. She just received her master's degree in industrial design, and she's from Colombia. She's actually from Bogota. I have very good impression of people from Colombia. And these are the all industrial design students. Not all of them, some industrial design students and of my faculty. So just one day we decided, Deanna made the presentation introducing this university, and the students came and we took a picture. And that's me, okay? When I was a bit younger, right? It's 6 months ago. Yeah, every year we all age. So, before NC State, I was a faculty member at Auburn University. From the ranking, you can see that Auburn was ranked as well. So I went to graduate school there. I studied industrial design there. And then I graduated. I worked for many years. I worked in the industry for 12 years. And in 2004, that was the first time I started teaching. I never taught full-time before, and I was invited to be an assistant professor of industrial design in 2004 at Auburn University. Okay, and at Auburn and NC State, even though I taught in different schools, all my studios, and I've been working and collaborating with companies, and these were the list, a partial list of the companies my students have been working with. I enjoy collaboration. I believe for industrial designers, working in a professional setting is the best way to learn and practice industrial design. So all these companies, even though I left in the industry and started teaching full time, I feel like I never left the industry, because I've been working with the companies all the time in both Auburn and NC State. On Saturday, I think Deanna, I'm going to have a presentation on Saturday to another open presentation. I'm going to introduce some of the projects that we did with this company. I do that on Saturday. If I do it all today, it's going to be dark when we go out. So we do it on Saturday. But I will be glad to show some of the works. But I cannot show every single project, because many of them are confidential. We sign agreement. We cannot show the project. But I can show quite a few things on Saturday. I'm looking forward to do it. So that's one example. Last semester, we worked with a company called Lowe's. Lowe's in the United States, the biggest home improvement company is stores, the Home Depot. And then the other one is Lowe's. They have 2,000 stores, $50 billion of sales, huge, huge company. And they came to us. They sponsored the studio. So these are my students. And they spend an entire semester studying how people use garage. Americans have garages. They park their cars in garages. And then, so they treat their cars very well. But in the meantime, many people use garage to be, to do things. Yeah, so so again, the mission, the project was to enhance the garage. How, because many people do things, make things in the garage. So students spend the entire semester, one third of the time, going to people's home to study how people use garage. Some people use the garage to park their cars. Some people use garage to play ping pong. Some people use garage to make things. They make furniture, they make things in the garage. And some people use their garage as an exercise gym. They put treadmills, exercise machine. There's many, many interesting things our students find out. And some of people use garage to put a jacuzzi, you know, the big bath. And so that's very fascinating. And our students spend good time in people's garage and come up with ideas. And just give you some idea how it works. So these are juniors. We are 4 years program. So these are, the students are juniors. Okay, and so the people, the designers from those came over every 2 or 3 weeks. So that's the design director. He went to Pratt in New York. He studied industrial design, and this gentleman, he studied industrial design in University of Cincinnati, another good program. And in the class, suddenly we have some very charming male and female students, and some students here. If you're interested in some of their phone numbers, I cannot give it to you. No, just kidding. Okay, but you can see that students are happy. So this is a very happy boy at the end of the semester, you know, coming with some beautiful products for the company. And this is just some information. This is an architectural student. He's an architectural student, but in his last semester, he decided to take industrial design studio, and he learned a lot. And also we have engineering students in the studio. And he's a student, exchange student from France. He spent a good time there. This student, her name is Lauren, similar to yours. And in the summer, she's interning with a company called Michael Kors. I do not know if I have Michael Kors here, but she's working as an intern designing shoes in New York. And this student, Eric, I'm laying a foundation for what I'm going to cover now. Eric is an intern at with a hotel chain, Marriott. You all know Marriott. I think there's Marriott Hotel in Bogota. It's a big chain hotel. And he's interning at Marriott in the summer because they are trying to learn the experience of their customers in hotel and come up with new design ideas. Okay, so that's the snapshot of the class. Come on here. Okay. You missed the most exciting part of the presentations. Okay. About myself, before teaching, I spent many years in the industry, and I most of the time, actually, for 12 years, basically, I do only one thing. I manage new product development. So I manage design teams, I manage engineering team, and then they asked me to manage production team, marketing team. So that's what I did. But I think that's the most important function of any companies, to come out with new products and sell it to the market. But a lot of time, I don't have many, many projects in my portfolio because every product takes many years. From the beginning, could be a sketch on the napkin, 2 years later is in a store, and it take a long time. So that's some project my team came up with when I was working in the industry. So these are some electric toy vehicles, right? You charge it and the children can ride. So these are some of the project we did for boys and girls. And during the design process, certainly there's a lot of compromise. The design was much more beautiful, much more aggressive than this. But then we came out with the design, and the engineers and production people said, wow, that's a lot of tooling cost. So we used this. We had a much more beautiful mirror here. But and the company said, well, it would be nice to save some cost. It's not here. By using some old parts. And this was much bigger. And then the company said, oh, that's a lot of tooling costs, injection molding. So they we can make it much smaller. So the whole thing looks much less aggressive. Okay, in production, it's very a lot of compromise, but certainly we are designing for the industry. Industry have to survive. So it's understandable, but at the end of the day, a lot of time designers are very frustrated by the fact they have to compromise a lot of their design. And then this is another product we work on. We got video games. That was here in the late 80s. And we have a simulator. So when people put it's for the arcade, right? People put in money and they write down playing games and the whole seat go up and down, left and right. And we learned a lot from the project and it was not successful. It became too expensive. So you can see that we had to find the right balance between design and production and engineering. And then this became a huge success with what we learned from there. And this is a project we designed for the casinos. And this was sold to Europe. I went to visit a company in Spain, and they bought some of the technology. We went to several Belgium and other companies. We sold a bunch of this. This is a dice machine used in early, again, late the very early 2000s, late 90s, the technology was very advanced. We use RFID technology to read the dice. So it was very advanced. We have many countries patterns. And don't play it. You're going to lose money. Okay, you're going to lose money. And this is a big money generator. And so it was a very successful project. And company made lots of money. But then when it became more and more successful, I decided not to pursue. I resigned from the company because, again, lots of opportunities. But one thing is, one time I took my marketing team to Prague, Czech Republic. And as a designer, and I like to go to the place that people use and use our products. So I spent almost a night, many hours in a casino. And there's an old gentleman sitting there for many hours. He lost a lot of money sitting in front of things that we designed. I feel really bad. I was thinking, I think his wife might not be very proud of what he has been doing. Maybe he was hoping to bring more money to his wife, but it didn't happen. I just feel very bad about it. So you know, not long after that, I resigned from the company. And the company was very angry that I started products and I left. But again, that's a conscious decision. Okay, this kind of thinking, if you were a designer of Apple iPhone or iPod, you might have a huge success. I'm sure Jonathan Ive will have a very good high sense of accomplishment, because I don't know how many millions of iPod or iPhone they sell. But you notice that because there are so many iPods and so many iPhones, and young people wearing earphones many, many hours a day for many years. And then there already research showing that this generation, when you guys are old, you're gonna have the worst hearing ability of all time. So in that case, I'm not sure Jonathan Ive will be very proud of his accomplishment, because you all gonna need hearing aids. So for those company, for those people who want to make money, 20 years later, 30 years later, start a hearing aid company. And our young people gonna need hearing aid, right? So, it's about the social responsibility of designers. And it's too early for the students, because you think, hey, I need a job first. You might design guns, right? Knives to kill people. But later on, you feel like, are you doing social good? Doing something, helping the community? Yeah, so. And that's the other thing my company did. We developed the technology to put videos, TV commercials on the website. It's very early on, I think my team put the first TV commercial on the internet in China and Japan, okay? But again, it's lots of noise. But anyway, so That's the point. Today, you see that you see TV commercials on website all the time. But when my team came up with that idea, it was a very novel idea, and people were very suspicious. And we were too advanced in the technology. So people had problem believing this. And even though we were the first one put this in the internet in China and Japan, but it didn't go far. And the other thing is the big company realized the need, and they came in and just take over the entire market. We had no place at all when the big companies come in. Okay, so sometimes we cannot be too advanced in technology. And that's the other thing. After that, I started my own company, and this is what we did. This might not be the most beautiful products, but the thing is, do you know what this is for? This is a furniture for children with disabilities. There are some children born early with cerebral palsy, with some challenges. So they, when they are growing up, they need tables, chairs to help them. So these were products. Because in Taiwan, I was in Taiwan during a period of time, and this product had to be imported to Taiwan from United States. And these products were very expensive in United States already, not to mention they ship all the way to Taiwan. Very expensive, and for those family with the children with the disabilities, they already have some financial hardship. So they cannot afford these kind of things. So my team designed and manufactured all these products in Taiwan. And 2 years later, these products become the number one products of in Taiwan, because you know, we designed for Taiwanese children, and also the cost was much lower. Right? And it might not look beautiful because we try everything to lower the cost. So all these things need zero tooling cost, no injection molding parts, no nothing, just all made of CNC routers and put together. So, and one thing is can adjust, the children grow up very fast, so they can use the same device for many years. And so that's one example that when we brought this product to one of the children, he was not able to sit on a chair because he was not able to support himself. He was lying down. But this was the first time this boy is able to sit in a chair. And you don't want to lie on the bed all day long, all year long, because it's not good for your circulation. So the children need to be standing or sitting from time to time. And the product is helping the children. So I have been fascinated by Bogota. It's a very fascinating city, even though I haven't seen a lot of part. But it's a beautiful city, but also got many, many problems. We all know that walking on the streets, we see people having some issues, problems. So I think as a design student, you have a lot of problems you can tackle, you can take on. Okay, because the social problems are designers' problems, not other people's problems. We are designing, we should be designing not for the people can afford the products. We also need to be designing for those cannot afford. Okay, so that's about myself, and it's all past. Let's talk about the future. Okay, one more thing, that's National Cheng Kung University, that's where I did my undergrad study. I studied industrial design in Cheng Kung University. And it's in Taiwan, but the building doesn't look like any Asian building. So yeah, it was a long time ago. Okay, so NC State, Auburn, and National Cheng Kung University, I think maybe including Harvard, many, many design schools in the world have a similar philosophical origin, warm, School of Design. I hope many of you have heard Ulm School of Design in Germany. So 1953, that's a model. The model of modern day design education started from Ulm. Okay. The professor of Ulm basically started many industrial design programs around the world. And if you're not familiar with Ulm, Ulm was established by the faculty and students of Bauhaus. Okay, Nazi closed Bauhaus, But then after World War II, the faculty and students started the UOM. And the UOM model basically is the model of modern day industrial design education and also architectural education. In UOM, design education, so that's why I'm talking about the future of design education and design practice. They had to go hand in hand. That started in UOM. In UOM, the faculty and the designers in the industry, they come back and forth. One year you might be a professor in UOM, and next year you'll be a designer in the industry. Maybe next year you come back. So lots of exchange. The students work for a company, and the faculty might be designing for companies, and just back and forth. That was the UOM model. And think about Stanford University, the Silicon Valley, just the model of that. And they started very early in UOM. So at schools, at UOM, the faculty offer the vision, the philosophy, knowledge, and skills for the students, okay, and also for the professionals. And the professionals, they verify the concept, the vision, and provide the practicality to the design education, so they go hand in hand as early as in the UOM School of Design. Okay, so this was some very classic, iconic design created by UOM for Brown. Brown is still selling products, but the early days there were before Sony, before Samsung, it was Brown. Okay, and the faculty at UOM and the designer at UOM, they worked together to come up with these beautiful designs, and they defined the design of many modern day products today. And they also, the graphic design faculty and students create this logo and brand identity for the German airlines, and you see that the German airlines, Lufthansa, are still using this brand identity today, even some little small refinement. And also, the faculty and students came up with this. Do you know what this is? It's a portable radio, right? You put it in a pocket, you can go anywhere to hear the radio. Do you feel like this looks familiar? And many people, I'm not sure, many people say that design inspired iPod. Okay, iPod. With iPod, they have iPhone, and most people have iPhone in your pocket. So you can see the influence of UOM in the modern day design. I know a few things about UOM because when I was studying at Auburn as a graduate student, we had only four or three graduate students, and my major professor, Dr. Watershear, he graduated from UOM, and he really liked me a lot. We had long conversations every day, so I have very good understanding of UOM's design philosophy. Okay, and so these days, the collaboration between the industry, the design, education and design industry still is very, very popular in the United States. That's Virginia Tech, University of Illinois, because I got friends in all there, Georgia Tech. They all working closely with the industry, just like similar to a UOM school model. But one thing is, in the collaboration, we need to think carefully the role between the industry and academia. Again, like what I mentioned, the academia can provide this, the practice can provide this, so they work together. But I think one thing we have to think very carefully where the balance need to be. Okay? So for example, in terms of the vision, the future, the bigger picture of design, the school should be the leader of the industry instead of industry tell academia, this is how you should teach the design. Okay, I am a firm believer that academia should be the leader of the vision of the professional. But there are some schools, I'm a little concerned about them because they are schools that have been told by the industry, this is how you should train your students. Some of the programs start losing their vision, start losing their philosophy.
So the philosophy, I think the academia should be having more impact than the industry, but it's fine to have the industry provide the school with the current relevant knowledge and skill set. So that should be the way, the model of collaboration. It would be a good balance in between. Okay, so that should be a good range. Okay, so in a collaboration, as we have lots of faculty members here, be careful not to become that they are pushing their visions into us. They are pushing their philosophy toward us. It might not be that we will be losing our value. Okay, but it's fine for the industry to provide us with a skill set with the most current knowledge. Okay, so the role of faculty and the designers is something we have to be carefully balanced to find the right balance, the right range. Okay, that's the first observation. The collaboration with the industry is going to continue and become stronger and stronger, but we have to be careful with the solution. Okay, and then the next thing I'm going to share with you about the future of design practice education, we're going to start with history. Future is the continuation of history. Okay, do you have to teach design history, to learn design history here? Yes, okay, so no. This is Walter Teague in the 30s, okay, in the 30s. So in his firm, he was one of the first industrial designers in the United States. In his firm, he designed this beautiful radio. Okay, radio was a big thing in early days. It's beautiful, and this is kind of Art Deco inspired radio. Early days industrial designers, they designed a lot of products, are designed similar to a building. The products look like a building, okay? So anyway, his firm designed cars, okay? His company, his design firm also designed a lot of architecture. This is the Chicago, the World Fair. Okay, they didn't have internet that period of time, so this is a showcase of the technology. Chicago, and this is the Ford exhibit hall. At that period of time, Ford was the biggest company on this planet. So when they want to show the power of the company, they hire the best designer to do it. And they hire industrial designer to design the exhibit. Huge, huge investment. And his firm was working on it. So look at see, he worked on electronics, transportation, his team, also space, and also this. Do you know what this is? Airplane. Let me show you a special cut. Uh-oh. That's it. Okay, sorry about technical problem. No. I can see the video, but it's not.
Well, yeah, but it's.
A little bit break. And the video will not go there. So.
Apareció por lo que he contado.
That's a slide. Ah, that's good. Can I show the video here? Let me see. Oh, Colombia. Come here. Let me see. No. Yeah, tea. Oh, this one. This one, yeah.
Yeah,
this one, yeah. Okay. Good. Okay, we got a video. So remember, this was very early days done by a design firm. It's coming. Yeah, it's there. It's coming.
When Boeing decided to enter the market with their 707, Walter Dorn Teague and Associates was awarded the contract for the design of the plane's interior.
As staff graphic designer Art Stremmen recalls, the Teague office set to work on the design. They wanted to do something special, something extraordinary, and they didn't want any executives interfering.
It was agreed that the decision makers at Boeing would be kept in the dark about the nature of the presentation until its unveiling.
Months of intense design work ensued in New York.
When it came time for the presentation, the Boeing executives and their wives were picked up at their hotels in Manhattan, driven by limousines to a large building downtown, and drove right onto a large freight elevator. The elevator stopped at the fourth floor and its doors slid open. They stepped out of the limousines and were escorted to a lounge arranged with small cocktail tables, comfortable seating, and a small bar. Across one wall was a maroon velvet drape. Mr. Teague stepped to the front of the curtain. All there had to be wondering what they were in for. What was on the other side of the curtain? A movie? A slideshow? Dancing girls? Mr. Teague began to talk about the scope of the project, the work that had gone into it. Then the curtain slid open. Then the door opened and a stewardess stepped out and said, "The initial flight of the Boeing 77 is ready for boarding. Welcome aboard." All those in the lounge, bewildered, one by one slowly rose to their feet.
And they found themselves inside a full-sized model of the entire aircraft interior, exact to the last detail. Even the galley and the lavatories were fully functional.
And we basically took a flight. They had sound and the lighting and everything was all worked out. It was going to fly so still that you could have a glass of wine on your table and it wouldn't spill and things. Because airplanes, before that, that was not the case.
The design for the 707 was a great success, introducing features for the first time in aircraft that became standard in future designs. More passenger windows, individual controls for air and lighting for each seat.
They designed in these recessed skylights, and the lighting would change from being indirect lighting, and you would have dawn and daylight and nighttime with stars and everything, and remember that very specifically. It was very exciting. I mean, you know, the jets, commercial jet travel had not happened yet, and this was the first experience we had with it. It was fabulous.
Okay. So from the video, from this project, the few things he mentioned more than one time. First of all, the full-size prototyping was certainly revolutionary at that period of time. Design is not just drawing, but prototype. And the other thing is, even though it's a lot of money, but they are willing to do investment, full-size prototyping. I wonder whether you heard a story or not. I really like this story that when Apple decided to start their own stores, Apple Store, and so because they used to be sold by Target, other stores, and Steve Jobs would like to see his products being sold in an environment he really liked. So he decided to open Apple Stores, very expensive investment. So he hired the best interior designers to design the Apple Stores. And then he was ready to start building a bunch of them in the United States. And he was fortunate enough that the CEO of Gap, the clothing company Gap, was on the board. And during a board of director meeting, the Gap CEO asked Steve Jobs that, did you test it? And Steve Jobs said, hey, we can test iPhone, we can test iPod. How can we test a store? And the Gap CEO said, yes, you should test it. So Apple rented a huge warehouse and built a full-size Apple store in it and brought real customers into it. And after some research, they decided to change the design entirely because what they learned from the real experience, from the prototype. So that's why we encourage the design students, if possible, try to build prototypes. So yesterday, I had the opportunity to tour your facility, and I asked to see the shop because I know that students, a lot of times, you have these fabulous computers, but don't forget, you can have a beautiful chairs in your computer, but there might be a pain to sit on. You never know until you prototype it, okay? The other things that they mentioned is experience. Experience was in the 50s. They talk about experience, okay? We're gonna continue. And this is Henry Dreyfuss. I think something wrong with the screen. We're losing. Missing some Anyway, we can continue while they're working on this. So this is Henry Dreyfuss. In his firm, in his practice, he designed many, many iconic products, from telephone to just a lot of things, including cars. And he also designed buildings. So the building, he worked with architect to design the buildings. Oh, that's great. It's good. So this was a building in New York, Manhattan, designed by an industrial designer, okay? So just in the early days, the designers, the design team, they work on all kinds of different products, including space. Okay, and this is Raymond Loewy. His famous project was the Coca-Cola bottle, okay? And then his firm, again, designed cars and designed space. This is an airline lounge. He designed. Okay, so you can see that in these days, the practice, they do pretty much everything. And that's the IMS couple. Okay, so they design space and they will train architects, but also they design furniture. Okay, so all these examples are trying to show you that in their practice, they design space, they design products, they design transportation, they design furniture, the early days. Okay, so
is very transdisciplinary. And actually, it was not a discipline at all. It was just design. And then over the years, and we need more and more expertise and knowledge in under each categories. So you can see that space, products, transportation, they become more, they have more and more knowledge required. So it's become more specialized. Okay, the specialization of this practice. So we have architecture, we have interior architecture, product design, that's what you are learning here. User experience design, transportation design, graphic design, furniture design, exhibit design. So it's becoming a lot of different disciplines, even though they started only pretty much, they started from the same team. Okay. And again, the expertise continue to expand, to grow bigger and bigger, right? Because, and then become more and more specialized. But one thing is, with the internet, many knowledge becomes available to people outside the disciplines. Okay, so used to be, if you're an industrial designer, you had no clue how to design a building. But with the internet, you probably can find a lot of information, codes, building codes about architecture. And it's not impossible, right, for one people doing the designer in one discipline do the other. So it's interesting that with the expansion of expertise, they start having overlap. So in today's practice, in many companies, they are having transdisciplinary design teams. They have people, they have architects, industrial designers, graphic designers working in the same project. So that's happening in this company because we work with this company. We know this is what happened in the last probably 5-10 years. This is happening. Okay. So you can see that in these teams, people, the designers from different backgrounds, they work together. Okay, and it's, the model is different. It's very interesting. It's for some people might think, okay, if we are doing a space project, that maybe industrial designer gonna do a space, graphic designer gonna do products, is usually not the case. The model should be in these companies, what they're doing now is when they are working on space, architects are working on space, but participated by industrial designers and graphic designers. When they are working on products, product designers, experienced designers, they're working on products, but architects, graphic designers could be part of the team. So that is an important model in a company these days. Interdisciplinary team, or I would rather call it transdisciplinary teams, but it's not like people do each other's job. People do not do each other's job. You still do your job and participate by people of different disciplines. That is the model of this today's the team, the design team. So that's happening in GM because we have a graduate working for GM right now, and they've been using this model. Okay, and Mayo Clinic is a very, very famous hospital in the United States, and they started a design team a few years ago. And at first, people were very suspicious, why you need designers in the hospital? But what they did is they have a design team with industrial designers, graphic designers, and architects. They go to different corner of the hospital and study how patients and how physicians, how doctors use the space and come up with a new design. So this is a patient room, for example. So the architects work on the space, industrial designers work on the furniture, graphic design work on the environment, things like that. So including the website. So designers still do the job, they are doing the best. But parties, they are working together as a team. Okay, so what we are seeing, what's happening, what I'm thinking is coming is, at the beginning, it's integrated transdisciplinary from the water tank to handy drivers, the team work on everything. And then we have a specialized for the specialized area for the last 20, 30, 40 years. And now it's coming back to this. But this is still different, have a little bit different take from the water vehicle handling drivers. This is a new integrated transdisciplinary design practice that's happening now. It will happen tomorrow. So you can see that things come around, okay? So that's the other thing I see in the future of the design. And education should be following the same path. But one thing is, there are some schools think, okay, we are going to focus on interdisciplinary design education. But like what I mentioned, in a transdisciplinary design team, graphic design still do graphic design. Architects still do space design. Product design still do product design. But they all work together, okay? So, but there are some schools, their interpretation of interdisciplinary is they have common courses. So some students go to a design college. They have no majors. They only major in design. So they learn a little bit product design. They learn a little bit architecture. They learn a little bit graphic design. So they hope that student can do everything. But do you think it's a good idea in today's setting that student can do everything? And some schools, University of Michigan, start experimenting a design program that very interdisciplinary, so students have no majors. But I'm a little bit concerned with that path. But I think the students, they still need majors. They still need to be very good at the majors. They still need their skills built on their discipline. Industrial design should be very good at the industrial design discipline. But they need to have interdisciplinary process and thinking. So that's two things, education. Thinking and process could be interdisciplinary, but in terms of the skills, your knowledge, still need to be very disciplined. So that I think that's going to be, is reflecting what's happening in the industry and how we should shape the design education this way, okay? So I'm not convinced by you major in design, and hoping that you can do anything. And I think you still have a very solid disciplinary training. But again, we have to provide interdisciplinary. The other things I noticed, we started with the water TIG film, and we noticed that in Bauhaus, in Ulm, they started as Bauhaus. The designers were educated, were practicing, focusing on the physical experience of people, of the users, physical experience. So they talk about ergonomics. Okay. So I remember my professor at Ulm, he said, if a product has no function, it's not a product, it's just a decoration. Okay, it's a piece of art. And he talked about ergonomics. So the students, I remember I was asked to be a critique in his studio. A student spent many days, many hours, many nights to build a coffee pot. Many hours make a model. And that period of time, in the 80s, there was no computer model. So American student came out with a model of the coffee pot. And during the final presentation, my professor feel like this angle is not right, it's not ergonomic. So he just took it apart. Many hours, many days, the students almost went mad, okay? So you can see that they're so focused on the physical experience, okay? And I think I don't have the gut to take my students' model apart right there, but he was able to do that because there's very strong belief in ergonomic. Okay, early days about physical experience, and certainly later on, they talk about behavior experience. It's not just the relation between the shape and product and your body, but also how you use the product. Use right hand or left hand, what you do first, things like that. And visual experience, the look, the styling, how pleasing a design is. So that was early days. But into Worms, they started talking a little bit more about the emotional, psychological, and cognitive experience of people using a product, using a space. They start talking a little bit more than that, but they didn't do too much on that. And the business experience, okay, the branding experience, internal branding experience. I like this story a lot again. I had a student, very brilliant student. Right as soon as he graduated, he got a job to be an industrial designer for Black & Decker, designing power tools. And then he came back to see me probably 6 or 7 months later. And I said, hey, how are things? And he said, because I was very sure that he would do great because he was brilliant. And he came back and said, you know, things are good, you know, company got good benefit, things like that. And I said, okay, how many products have you done that gonna be on the market? He said, zero. I said, zero? You've been doing great, you're brilliant, a company is not making any of your design to products. He said, the thing is, he started there, he came up with very good idea, many good ideas, he think, and a very beautiful design. And he showed his design directors. And his design director told him that all you did was great, but they do not look like Black & Decker products. Okay? So you can see that the branding experience is very important part of this. Everything is great, but they do not look like Black & Decker. Just if you get a job as a BMW designer, you can come out with beautiful cars designs, but they might not never produce yours because yours might not look like a BMW. Okay? So in Bauhaus, they didn't talk about it. Because in the things, people getting more sophisticated in the business environment. But in Ulm, they started a little bit more than that, but not sufficient enough. Okay. So in today, in the future, you can see that the physical experience is not going to reduce. It's gonna still be important. The visual experience, still experience, it never got reduced. But the challenge is the value, the significance of emotional, psychological experience, the value of business branding experience, the value of social, cultural, environmental experience is gonna be more and more significant. So it's more difficult, more challenging to be a designer these days because you had to do this very well, but you also have to do this well. And a lot of times, these are becoming the decisive factors of the success of products. Okay? So that's what's happening in industry, in the business. But think about education. How can we prepare the students for this kind of environment? And these are becoming more and more important. That is something that the faculty has to think about it, to think very hard, including myself. Okay, so, in the design teams, which they talk about, you know, water tea, they talk about experience. And now the experience has been expanded not to the physical experience, not the visual experience, the entire experience of the journey that the product, the first time they see or hear a product, all the way until they finish doing the product, the entire journey. That is something, the experience we are looking at. We should be designing for. That should be our scope. So with that, in the design practice, in companies like IDEO, IBM, in the design teams, they started invited sociologists, anthropology. Yesterday we had a conversation about anthropology, their value to design, okay? Business strategy, marketing people, they all having a seat in the product design team these days, okay? So this is happening in the industry, that in the practice. But in terms of education, think about this. Should we start asking the student to take psychology? I know psychology is elective, it's not required for many schools, but should we start asking, because the significance of these layers, should we start emphasizing more, should we start asking the student to take psychology, sociology, anthropology, business, marketing, and so on, so they can be more prepared for tomorrow, for future practice? That's something we have to think about it. So Deanna, you talk about anthropology, we talk about that. So is something, I don't have an answer, but we have to think about it, how we prepare the student for this kind of practice, okay? But certainly there are challenges, easier to say and then done. for example, psychologists, we have some students take psychology. They come back frustrated because the psychology class was not prepared for design students. Look at all this content. The student might find the entire 18 weeks, they might find only 1 hour or 2 hours the design students got excited. And most of the time, they feel like it's boring. They talk about a lot of other things. So we have to see that how we can prepare a psychology class for psychology. And then think about this. We start seeing that some industrial designers getting PhD in psychology, or some psychologists start taking a PhD in design. So you can see they're gonna be in the future gonna be some more interesting psychology courses for designers. Okay? So that would be something to think about it. Sometimes we got students thinking, I want to do a PhD, I don't know what. Industrial design itself might not need a PhD, you need practice. But think about this context, that is gonna be valuable. And for the students, taking psychology, the hope is they have appreciation and understanding, so they know the context, they are able to communicate with the psychology in the design team, not necessarily become a master of psychology. That could be the idea. Okay, our design students will never be a psychologist, will never be a sociologist, but with a good understanding, appreciation, they're gonna become better designers. So the inclusion of these courses in the design education for future design practice was not my invention. This was a map developed by the faculty of WOM in the 1950s. And these are German, I don't know German either, but maybe Spanish have a lot of similarity. But that's the English. You can see that they didn't do it, they didn't implement it. But you can see that in 1950s, in their hope, in their plan for the design education, they have psychology here. And they have sociology, they have business here. So I really admire the vision of these educators in WOM in almost 70 years ago. They saw it, even though they didn't implement it. And now, design schools, we still not implementing it. But sooner or later, they're gonna be a very important part of our education. So that's a reason for this, and I have explained the reason. Okay, so look at the design practice and educational future. I think gonna be the convergence of these three things. The good balance between education and industry, the good balance in collaboration. And starting from the transdisciplinary team, become very specialized and go back to transdisciplinary design practice education. And the significance value of psychology, emotion, business into a design practice and design education. So I think these three gonna be the corners of future design practice and design education. So that's something we can think about it. Okay? And just so give some idea of this was, you saw the film by Walter Tigg. It was early days, but I would like to, if possible, let me show you the film that this was that he graduated from NC State. He's from India. He came in with a mechanical engineering degree, but he spent 3 years getting an industrial design master degree, and he's a director with RKS, a big firm in Los Angeles. And this is his project. Let's see if we can play that video here. In a junk drive, yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah, the media. Yeah, the media. And that's it. Yeah. Okay. So they are probably 60, 50 years apart, but designing an airplane. Oh, that's sea air. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. is just example of what could happen next. This is just a concept. It's no airline called Sea Air. It's no such airline. But this project was done probably in a week by an industrial designer, an architect, and graphic designers. The focus is about the entire, like what I mentioned, the entire journey. The journey started from people get on the website and book their flight all the way until they get an airplane. The entire journey, that should be the focus of design practice today and tomorrow. Okay, so not just the design of a seat, the design of the cabinet is the entire journey. And that will be the focus of design. The scope of a design education is going to be transdisciplinary and focusing on entire experience. Okay, so that the future of design practice and also design education. Okay, thank you. That was my presentation.
Bueno, si alguien tiene alguna pregunta que le quiera hacer al profesor Zailu, ya sea sobre su experiencia en North Carolina State University o de lo que presentó sobre el futuro de la práctica y la educación de diseño, entonces están bienvenidos a hacerlas. La pueden hacer en español y yo le traduzco, o la pueden hacer directamente en inglés si prefieren.
Good morning, Professor. I don't know if I have any problem. I'm going to ask for help, Andres. How have you managed this issue of, or I don't know if you have the issue, but right now here in Colombia, we have this resource problem. And this about, we have had these big programs, including all the last things you said, psychology, philosophy, and so on. But right now, we are like in a crisis, and both public and private education, well, they say they had no the resources to invest on those kind of subjects. Mm-hmm. How have you managed that, if you have had the problem? Or what could we do? Because we had this conflict right now.
Okay, that's a very good question. And be honest with you, I need some time to think about it, because I just arrived about 36 hours ago. I don't have good understanding of the program and the economy yet. But so I'm, that's why in the afternoon I'm probably gonna have some time to understand your program. But yesterday, be honest with you, I was very impressed by your facility. You have probably better facility than my school. Okay, so and we every school they always talk about the constraints and resources. That's why. But I think you got a very good facility. So in that regard, I think you are even better than us. Okay, we have lots of space, but might not be as good space. And certainly there's a challenge of a bigger program. I manage a smaller program, but I have two programs. Sometimes they don't work very well together. Sometimes and but. There are always issues everywhere, but the one challenge is maybe we can try to be creative in this. So you have many students, and how to prepare the student to enter the whole spectrum of industry. So maybe you, many schools, they're still hoping that students can get a job as in a car company, furniture companies, electronics company. That's great. We still have many students work on this. But in the meantime, we need to prepare students working in a whole new set of business sectors. We are having students working for Marriott Hotel, working for hospitals, working for government agencies. There's many, many in banks, financial institutions. So this kind of training, industrial design training, product design training, gonna prepare the students. If we use the same concept, we care about the customer experience, and then they're gonna be open up many new opportunities for our students. And in terms of education, certainly adding more courses, So psychology, sociology is going to be taking away some courses from students, but maybe there's some way to do it. We've been having a conversation like, for example, psychology. Do design students need to take a whole semester of psychology? Maybe we have one semester. We spend half the time in psychology, the other half of the time in sociology. So cut into small pieces, or used to be 3 credit hours for psychology, but design students might not need 3 hours of psychology. They might need only 1 hour. So we can open up the other possibility, take sociology or marketing. So I might not have the answers, but there may be different ways, creative way to do it. So this is my thought. This is my thought. But I feel like designers are in a really good place with problems. We'd be bored if we are in a place with little problems. So problems make designers better. And so there are great opportunities for designers to be successful. And I really think Bogota would be a very good place to be a design center for the South America. And because the diversity of your people, diversity of your economy, and many challenges, social problems, financial problems, and all play come out as a very good platform for designers to come out with brilliant design to help with society. So yeah, I don't have one concrete answer, but this kind of touch, and I hope that will kind of answer your question. Okay, thank you.
I have a question. Most of the companies that you showed, they are big companies, very marketing brand driven. I agree completely with you in the necessity of the design team to be transdisciplinary, interdisciplinary. How do you keep design decisions part of the design team and not lost to the marketing area of the company?
That's a classical, typical issues of designers. The designers, a lot of times, got frustrated working with the marketing people, business people, right? And one thing is, we also did some projects with small companies, very small companies. I didn't show them because if I show the name, people don't know. So we also work with small companies. But if we work with small companies, sometimes we have only one student or two students working with them. Okay, so we do work with small companies, and sometimes it's very entrepreneurship, a kind of small projects. But it's a very big, a very good issue that how people in a company, no matter how big or small the companies are, they value design. Okay, so the thing is, it's mutual. It's we cannot just blame marketing people. You don't understand me. We cannot blame engineers. You don't understand me enough. But we have to make them understand us better. So many engineers, many business people think we are putting makeups. We are like putting cosmetics on people. So one not very good example, the saying in the United States that we are the people that put lipsticks on pigs. So they finish everything, we just put some lipsticks, or just make it, just wear some makeup. And it's a very wrong idea. We are not just making things beautiful in the last minute. If they are still thinking that's a designer's value, we always gonna have issues working with the team. Okay, so we are doing much more than making things beautiful. Okay, so you know, from the way we discover issues in the entire journey, people need to start understanding the value of design. It's not just putting makeup. Okay, but unfortunately, many design education, many design students are still being regarded as they put makeups when the things are done. So we can be much more valuable, not just functionality, not just engineering, but also the entire value of the product or service. Okay, we have an example that a few years ago, our engineering department came to us. They said, hey, we came up with a new idea that when people go to a public library, very big, people get lost. They cannot find, for example, bathrooms. So they invented a tour robot. So use very low cost technology. So if somebody go to a public library, say, oh, I need to find a bathroom, the person just talk to that robot, and robot can take that person to a bathroom. Okay, so it's good idea. The students are very smart. They came up with low cost technology, and then they come up with a prototype, and then they ask us to help with the prototype to make it nicer looking. Okay, that's a typical example of their conception of designers. And then when we saw the prototype, I'm almost fainted. Okay, they put all the technology in a box, and then put four wheels on the box. So the technology is basically this low. So when the people come to the library, I say, hey, how can I find a bathroom? So that's engineer's solution, right? We got involved. We can make the box more beautiful, but who gonna like using it? It's beautiful, you are beautiful, how can I find a bathroom? So the from the conception of the product, what's wrong? The robot need to be at least our eye level, right? And it was too late. So that's the issue with many companies. They say, hey, we come out with all the technology, maybe before we sell it, have industrial designers just put some makeup on it. Then we always kind of have this identity and value issues. People don't value us. But if we look, we think bigger, we look at entire experience, look at entire journey beyond the artifacts, we're gonna be much more valuable. Okay, so.
Hi, Professor. I find your approach is highly linked with the traditional forms of industry. So I'm wondering, how do you envision the engagement designers can provide with new forms of production or emerging forms of industry, as fab labs, creative industries, media labs? Mm-hmm. How do you see that? Okay.
Yeah, that's a very good question. It's going to be a challenge. And again, from what I said at the beginning, I don't have any answers. And different people have different views. But I think all these new technology provide a great tools for industrial designers to create more impact. Okay, so with the rapid prototyping, 3D printers, all this virtual reality, I just hired a new faculty member starting the fall. He got a PhD from MIT. His expert is computation in design. He gonna teach coding to my graphic design and industrial design student. He's going to teach virtual reality. So we are trying to, because since we are talking about the entire experience, and sometimes the entire experience, entire journey will be really difficult to model. It's easier to model a chair. But it's not easy to model the entire experience from you go to a furniture store, you select the furniture and get the manufacturer, and like airplane things. A lot of technology can help to study how people's interaction with the new design. So technology will be very helpful. But one thing is, I feel like living in a big university with big engineering program, and I've been telling people that I think that technology should be developed for the sake of people, not for the sake of technology. Sometimes we got lots of engineers, they develop technology for technology, but our value would be we should develop technology for human beings. So that's what very, very, very consistent from the very beginning. We focus on people. We study people and come up with solutions. We need technology. We go out for help. All the new technology is going to help us be more effective in coming up with a new experience. Okay, that's my thought.
Professor Sailu, let's talk about the relationship between companies and universities. I had an interesting discussion with some of my students last semester about international design competitions sponsored by companies. Because they told me that the only winners with the final product will be the company. I think different, but what do you think about this type of competitions that can be used for educational strategies?
Yeah, that's very good. And we also struggle with that. When we are working with a project with a company, the students have to sign an agreement. And so for example, Coca-Cola. We did a project with Coca-Cola, and Coca-Cola owned all the designs. The students, sometimes students cannot even show the project in the portfolio. But what I really value, I encourage you students to do is, because you will never start a company as big as Coca-Cola. So what you what be valuable is what you learn from the process. So design competition is great. I've been encouraging our students to participate in design competition. And so if sometimes competition costs money to enter. So if company would like to sponsor it, would be great. But students sometimes don't have to worry too much about the intellectual property. Because what is valuable is if sometimes students think, oh, I come up with this great idea. I'm going to start a new company. I'm going to make a lot of money from this. But again, from a concept to a commercialization, it takes years, take a lot of money. And a lot of time, you might find out that it's not worth it. It's easier if you do well, you get a good job. And that will make everything worthwhile. So that's why I encourage your students. This might be wrong, but I just encourage my students to continue to practice and don't worry that much about protecting the IP. It's about keep doing and make yourself well known. If you are famous, they're gonna go for you. Right? And so that's my thought. And you people might not agree, but I encourage our students to do as much as possible.
Hello, and thank you very much for your presentation. My question is more about, you were talking about another disciplines that you are encouraging to work with industrial design, like architecture, graphic design. But what about others, like mechanical engineering, administration, like a business or something? So what is the role of those departments or colleagues that you have in the university working with the design department?
I didn't point them out because it was focused on design. But you can see that in product development team, we have marketing, we have business people involved, and engineers. So they should be part of this. And our students in my program, our students are very used to working with engineers because there's a very big engineering school students to be working with. So many students, engineering students, they have their senior project. The project they do before they graduate, they come to us and have our design students working with them. So we're very used to working with them. We have some courses that have business students, engineering students, and design students working together on some projects. So for example, they might come up with a new concept of a new way to control the slides. And industrial design students might be design the spice or the device. Engineering students might design the inside technology. And business students have to write a business plan, a marketing plan for this. And then they almost feel like they almost can start a new company. So that's, we have some courses doing that. And the students learn a lot from that. So we are working on that, and that's a very good idea, and we are doing that. And we are not the only one doing that. Many schools are doing that, and more schools are doing that, encouraging the interaction between engineering, design, and business. Okay.
Anybody else has a question? Okay, so thank you very much, Professor Sai Lu, and welcome to the Tadeo University.
Okay, great to be here. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.